what if there is something that you're meant to do? And maybe you could have a desire. For me, I didn't, that wasn't in my awareness, but maybe you do. Maybe you have this desire that you've been, you know, trying to deny for a long time, that you wanted to experiment and try something and create something and put something out into the world in your own terms and, you know, create your own business. And it doesn't mean that you have to, you know, if you're in a financial situation where you've lost your job and you really can't afford to be without a job, it doesn't mean that you have to, you know, take the risk and end up living in your car and like put go all in to create a business. You can actually get yourself another job, but still commit to, okay, maybe I'll get a job that won't be as busy and I'll start a part-time business. But you can make decisions from a point of view of, what if this happened for me? What if this, you know, whether it's, you know, you get fired or you get laid off or you feel like you have to leave. If you could just open up and say, what if there's something here that's actually good for me? And that will lead you on a different path.
Hey, it's Rocky. Welcome to Richer Soul. Today's guest is Sandra Francisco, who helps people start and grow their business ideas. Imagine it's 12 months from now, and you've achieved your major life goals. How does it feel to be in the best shape of your life? To wake up energized, excited about the day? To have great relationships and friends who support you and propel you forward? How does it feel to have an excess of money, to be able to make the choices you want, to be fearless and open to trying new adventures? Imagine being connected to the universe and it providing everything you desire. It's possible over time, and your past does not dictate your future. The only thing holding you back from this vision is you. It's time to take control of our thoughts and use them to our advantage. Welcome to Richer Soul, where we achieve our dreams and bring balance to health, wealth, relationships, time, and spirituality. If you have not had a chance to listen to episodes 1-9, I encourage you to go back and listen to the framework behind Richer Soul and how to create the life of your dreams. You can also find all the show notes for this episode at richersoul.com. While you're there, you can sign up for a monthly email where I share the best articles I read this month, let you know about upcoming episodes, and share a little wisdom. You can also listen to coaching calls under the Coaching Calls tab. I also share the most interesting articles I read every week on Facebook at facebook.com/richersoul. And there's also a Facebook group where you can ask questions and interact with other listeners. Today's quote is from Seth Godin. The challenge, it turns out, isn't in perfecting your ability to know when to start and when to stand by. The challenge is getting into the habit of starting. We're going to focus on starting today. Starting is the hardest part of achieving your dream life. Before we move on, let's review last week's action step, which was to take one area of your life and start working on it. Our guest today may provide you a solution to an area you can work on if you haven't already picked something and worked on it. We always need to be growing because the world is always changing and we need to keep up. Standing still is no longer an option. I always thought that owning a business was risky, but the reality is working for someone is risky, as they can let you go without notice just because the economy goes bad or the company hits hard times. They also get to limit your income. I have some friends that were let go this year through no fault of their own, and I noticed they faced a big ego bruise and even anger. They knew that this could happen, and there were already telltale signs that this was going to occur. And they knew it had nothing to do with them, but they still have to deal with it, and they still have to deal with the emotions of it. Having a side business or building your own can create security if done correctly. I struggled with this for many years, and I finally figured it out. Today, we're going to chat about how you go from no idea to creating something that gives you freedom. Even if you're happy at work, it doesn't hurt to create a side hobby where you get paid to do your hobby. We're also going to chat a lot about overcoming ourselves. Listen to Sandra's money story growing up and how long it took for her to overcome that. Sandra Francisco is a business coach that helps entrepreneurs go from idea to profit while balancing their personal growth so they can have true fulfillment and extraordinary profit. Sandra spent 15 years as a marketing and product development expert for two of Canada's Fortune 10 companies, managing $50 and $100 million projects while leading thousands of people. After making the difficult decision to leave the corporate path, she found herself exploring professional coaching and the dynamics of the human psyche. As a co-founder of Human Potential International, Sandra holds a business commerce degree and is a certified in multiple modalities of the human psyche and peak performance. The combination of her eclectic background in personal and professional development translates to a unique and exceptional understanding of people, from multi-million dollar business owners to entrepreneurs that are just getting started. Let's meet our guest. Welcome to Rich Your Soul, Sandra Francisco. It's great to have you join us today.
Thank you, Rocky. It's a pleasure to be here.
And I'm excited for the conversation. As always, we start at the beginning. What was it like when you were growing up, and how much did your family and school teach you about money?
Yeah, I've had to unlearn a lot of that. So for me, I actually grew up with parents that were immigrants to Canada. I came to Canada when I was 10 years old. I was born in Portugal. And not that, you know, that they were trying to do any harm, but just the life that they were living, everything was scarcity based. It was always like, if I asked for something, oh no, that's too expensive, or, you know, we can't afford that. And there was a lot of that language. And I just always felt there was something in me that just always felt like, that's not true. That's not true. And as soon as I was 17 and I got a job, I always wanted to prove them wrong and to see like, no, there's abundance. Scarcity is not true. So early on, I just started to be very excited about making money. And when I, you know, went to university, actually was in a co-op program, right, second year of university. So I started making even more money than my dad by the time, you know, I was early 20s. So I always thought that, you know, I kind of had broken through those beliefs. But then when I started my own business, that was a different story. But definitely growing up, it was a lot of constant programming of scarcity.
So how have you unprogrammed yourself or reprogrammed yourself?
Yes, reprogrammed, true. It's all about the reprogramming. And, you know, it became a necessity when I started my business 10 years ago. As I said, when I went into corporate, it because I had such energy, a lot of motivation to prove my parents wrong, everything kind of came together the way I expected or the way I wanted in corporate. And I kept getting raises and I kept doing well. And I graduated at a time when IT was booming, and I actually have a business degree, but I went into a very technical role, and it was, they just wanted to keep you. So, you know, my boss would be coming to me saying, here's, I'm going to give you another raise and another raise. So I was totally in my 20s, early 30s, thought I didn't buy into any of my parents' money beliefs. And then when I left corporate and I started my own business, whole new world. All of a sudden, I started to see different things. I started to see the flow of money. Sometimes it would come in and sometimes it would stall. And then I was like, okay, I've got to, you know, do something about this. So the reprogramming started with first questioning, starting to question, okay, if I believe the physical world doesn't lie. So if I'm having a flow issue where I can see that now there's quite a few people that know about me and I had done my work and I was still getting some, you know, not enough clients that I thought I should be getting based on the exposure that I had. So then I had to do the work to see, okay, am I picking up on any of these beliefs? And I love Byron Katie's work where it's question based. So I did a lot of questioning on the beliefs, like, and I would keep a journal of for like a week worth at a time, what's coming up for me when I think of my value, my worth, and my relationship with money. And boy, was I surprised that those beliefs were there.
You know, until you question yourself and you ask and you look, you don't know. You're essentially running whatever programming was created when you were a child. And, yes. And that's not just true for money. It's true for all parts of our life. And that's why we have to go back and constantly examine what scripts are we running and do they serve us anymore?
100%. I do that with everything. Like anytime I see something that's not lining up the way that I, you know, desire or what I'm looking for, the first go-to is, okay, let me be aware first. Let me allow awareness, because sometimes human beings are very good at going into denial because we want to band-aid things or we don't want to feel negative emotions. So I just allow myself to go into the awareness, find it first. Then I go into some questioning. And then if I need to, then I go and get help. I mean, I love the network that I have now of coaches, therapists, and, so many spiritual practices, as well as, other practices that are fundamental, and so many new practices that even this year that I've learned from so many clients being in a difficult year this year. And I go to my resources, because the one thing I never want to get stuck on is living out somebody else's programming. If it's not mine, I'd like to clean it up.
And that's the problem, because all of our programming was created by somebody else at some point. For example, your parents, right? They taught you certain programming and you did fight it, but it was still running in the background. And so you do have to go do that work and figure it out. Just out of curiosity, was life much different in Portugal before you came to when you moved to Canada?
Oh, yes. Talk about doing my work. I'm still doing my work on that. It was, so I grew up in the south of Portugal. So I, had the beach by me as well as mountains and completely surrounded by nature. My grandmother had a farm and she's like my first entrepreneur that I watched. And I was free. I literally would pick up my bike in the morning and come home in the dark. Like before I was 6, 7, 8 years old. And my mother never even knew where I was, somewhere in a field. She was fine. There was no, like in society, there was no kidnapping or anything like that. No one worried about that stuff. So I had just freedom. I lived in nature. It was a completely different life. I came to Canada, I moved downtown Toronto. So I went from being in a farm surrounded by nature to surrounded by concrete and buildings. And that affected me so, so deeply. And then also I started school and I didn't speak English. And for the first 6 months, I didn't even know what was going on. And, then you get the kids that are mean and make fun of you for being different. And then I grew up with that when I was in Portugal until I was 10, I had a very natural self-confidence and everyone around me gave me that feedback because I was one of the only kids in an area that was a lot of older people that lived there in the village. So I was everybody's little kid, right? So I had so much accolation. And then, all of a sudden all these kids in grade 5 would say things about me. And I'm like, it took me a while, but then I was like, oh, maybe they're right. Maybe I'm not special. And then began decades of feeling like there was something wrong with me. I'm different. There's something wrong. And really now the last decade has been working on undoing all of that.
Well, it's good you're doing the work. So has there been something that you found recently that isn't, we all know about coaches and different modalities, but is there a modality you found that created, I'm not going to say faster results, but really helped dramatically shift your thinking or help you reprogram?
Now I'm going to say there's a few, but 2020 is the number one thing I'm going to say has helped me shift drastically. I feel like there's an energy in the air this year that started around the March timeframe that put everything on fast forward. And I see this for myself and I see this for every client I've worked with this year. And there's just almost like whatever you were getting away with, like when you weren't speaking your truth or things that you wanted to kind of sweep under the rug, like you were able to somewhat get away with it. And all of a sudden there's been this energy in the air of confront your truth. And that is it. I've seen it across the board. And for me, because I've been feeling that energy and been feeling like everything is on fast forward, it's actually gotten me to look for other modalities. I actually did a course with Susie Batiste this year, a few months ago. And I don't know if you guys don't know her. She's now been listed on Forbes, one of America's richest women. And her company, I think, is worth $500 million at this point. It's Poopery. And she's also a very spiritual leader. And actually, she's now building her brand as a spiritual leader. And she, just doing the course with her and seeing somebody that's you know, worth millions of dollars, but speaking about, you know, light and being true to yourself and all kinds of different modalities that she uses, both at therapies as well as different spiritual healings. And seeing her has been such an expander. She's been such an expander for me. And some of the therapies she's actually introduced me to that I didn't even know before, somatic therapy. And that's something that I learned just a few months ago with her. And I actually did a therapy here locally with horses, where they use the horses as a way for the horses to feel what you're feeling, and then they feed back to you. So it's like, it's kind of like seeing a mirror of what's really going on with you. That was an amazing session that broke me through a lot of my feeling like I didn't belong, like being different, a lot of that from moving. So that's definitely a new therapy that you can, it's a registered psychologist or psychotherapist to do that. So you can look in your area for somatic therapy. That was huge. As well as there's EMDR therapy that I've had clients have a lot of great feedback with as well. Susie talked about MDR as well. And, you know, hypnosis is something I haven't done too much of this year. I've been doing more of deep imagining and really going into that space of like kind of in between conscious and unconscious, and looking at what is it that I want my life to look like, and kind of programming, deliberately programming what I intend for my day to be like and my future to be like. So definitely, yes, lots of new therapies and lots of new things this year.
That's impressive. And I think it's important for you. We all have to decide what we want out of life. And I think it's one of the things that we're never taught. We're not taught money. We're not taught how to create our own life. We're all taught what we should live as life, but not, we're never given the freedom to say, this is what I want in a non-judgmental space. Because even if you go to your parents and say, well, I'm thinking about doing this, they're like, oh no, you can't do that. That's risky, right? You've got to follow this standard path, and they don't do it to try and harm you. They just want to keep you safe. They're not, you know, that's that whole struggle of success and reaching heights, but they're afraid. So they want to keep you protected. And it's counterintuitive.
Yes, it is. And even we do it to ourselves. Like we try to keep ourselves safe, and therefore we betray ourselves. Like we do it too.
That we do. So one of the things that I wanted to talk about is, you know, with COVID, there is a tremendous amount of turmoil. I think a lot of people early on lost their jobs, and most of those people were in the restaurant, in the service, maybe in some retail businesses. But as we go through this economic cycle, I'm now starting to see large companies doing cutbacks. And so you've got a lot of people with a lot of uncertainty. And I know someone just the other day had just posted he's in engineering and he lost his job, and it had nothing to do with him. Companies are just making decisions, and it's kind of the shock of that and the struggle of that. But yet everything happens for a good reason. So what I'd like to talk about is, how do we turn a job loss into what you say could be our greatest achievement?
True. Yes. And I think this is definitely the time that people need to hear that that is possible, because I think when we don't have expanders and people that can tell us their truth and that that's happened to them, then we don't even believe that's a possibility. And for me, to answer that, I'll just give you how I transitioned from job to business. It wasn't that I made a choice that, you know, even though I have a formal background in business and that's what I studied, I didn't have that decision of, oh, okay, I'm going to leave corporate because I just really want to be an entrepreneur. And that was not my story. I actually, my entire identity was really attached to corporate. And before that, it was, you know, being a good student, then it was being a good employee. And my title was what I identified as. And it happened that the year before I left corporate, I started to experience really severe anxiety that went largely undiagnosed for a year, because it didn't look like anxiety. I actually would get, my heart would race to like very high, like 160, 180. And it would stay like that for days, sometimes 3-4 days. So every time I would go to a lot of different cardiologists and check my lungs and check all these different things, because they didn't see that as a typical anxiety. And after they did a whole bunch of tests a year later, because it would come and go, but a year later, one specific doctor said to me, you know, Sandra, we've done everything. There's nothing we can find. You have to resign to the fact that this is anxiety, which he acted as if I had already known this. And I'm like, this is the first time anyone's ever said this. So after that, I felt like the medical system was saying, hey, we can't help you. Go figure this out for yourself. Not that they said that. I felt that that's what they were saying. So I kind of looked at the fact that I had this really busy job that was in IT and technology. So it was really 16 hours. It was an even 9 to 5. It was, you know, most of the time, 12 to 16 hours. I had 2 little kids. And I was like, if I have to heal myself now, I can't also do this and have this job. This isn't going to work. So I chose to leave because I felt like my life was at stake. So I left to heal. And it was in that space that I actually had no idea I was going to start a business. I just left and I went to the library, got a book on, you know, anxiety and started to heal myself. And then I, you know, a month later, I was like, but if I stay home doing nothing, I'm going to get worse. So now I have to find something that I could do. So I actually just literally saw an ad in a magazine for a school that taught nutrition. I didn't want to be a nutritionist, but I thought, how far can I go from technology? Let me go to nutrition. And I didn't know it at the time, but what I was trying to do is get back to my roots of nature. Because I think not consciously, but unconsciously, I knew if I could get closer to nature, I could heal as well. So I went and took this program. And there I met a lot of people that had these great ideas for products, for services, and they just didn't have the business background. They didn't know how to put it together. So I just casually started to help them. And I always knew that I wasn't going to leave here and, you know, become a nutritionist, but I thought, oh, I'll figure that out later. I'll go get another job. And then when I would get their feedback of like, well, why are you going to get a job? Like, why don't you just start a consulting business? Like, you've helped me build my business. And that's what led to consulting. And then consulting led to coaching. And, you know, 10 years later, I'm still in business for myself. But the transition, it happened. I always say my purpose kind of found me. And I stayed open because I was so focused on healing myself that I kind of stayed open on, okay, what's next with the next step? So I know what I would say to people that are in that space of either they feel like they need to leave because they feel like their life is at stake, like I did, if that's your, you know, physically or mentally or something, or you're asked to leave, either laid off or fired, that it may not be a horrible thing. It may not be the end of the world. What if there is something that you're meant to do? And maybe you could have a desire. For me, I didn't, that wasn't in my awareness, but maybe you do. Maybe you have this desire that you've been, you know, trying to deny for a long time, that you wanted to experiment and try something and create something and put something out into the world in your own terms and, you know, create your own business. And it doesn't mean that you have to, you know, if you're in a financial situation where you've lost your job and you really can't afford to be without a job, it doesn't mean that you have to, you know, take the risk and end up living in your car and like go all in to create a business. You can actually get yourself another job, but still commit to, okay, maybe I'll get a job that won't be as busy and I'll start a part-time business. But you can make decisions from a point of view of, what if this happened for me? What if this, you know, whether it's, you know, you get fired or you get laid off or you feel like you have to leave. If you could just open up and say, what if there's something here that's actually good for me? And that will lead you on a different path.
And it is a journey of exploration. I know it took me probably 7 years to get through that whole transition. I knew I wanted something different. I didn't know what it was, and I didn't know when it would happen, but I decided to at least start going down a path. And that continually opened more doors, and it also closed a lot of doors in saying, okay, I've gone here and I've done this. I don't want to be here. Like, I'm looking around at people who do this type of work, and I'm like, this is not me. This is not where I belong. So make a pivot and keep going. And I think over time, you eventually can find that perfect match for you. And so for me, it's been an interesting journey. I don't know to say that my purpose found me. I think it's more, I finally figured out how my gifts could serve the world. Right?
Good for you. Yep.
And so now I have a lot of fun doing it. And even though I'm working more than I've ever worked in my life, it's not work.
Yes.
So it's fun, right? It's enjoy. And I'll be honest, I think if you had told me 10 years ago, this is what it would be like, I don't think I would have believed you.
Oh, me too.
Because you just can't see it, right?
Oh, you can't see it until you can see it. Yes.
Yeah. And so that probably brings up the the next question, which kind of falls in line, is why our beliefs could be limiting us from that kind of growth.
And most of the time, our beliefs are limiting us from growth unless we're already growing, right? So again, look at your physical world. It won't lie. It will tell you where you're at, right? If you can feel like, and you can look around and see, yes, I can look how much I've grown the last 3 months, 6 months, you know, few years. I mean, I can look back and say, like, I'm a better human being overall than I was 10 years ago when I was wrapped up in the corporate world and I felt like that is who I am. The job is who I am. I've had to do a lot of work. There's been a lot of times that has been painful to break through beliefs. And I know that I am growing and that I am, you know, better than I was. It's not perfect. It's just, I'm just evolving and getting better and better. But if you're finding that you feel like you're stuck somewhere or stuck in a rut, or you're not happy with you or with where you're at, then there probably are beliefs that are limiting you. And again, I will say that it's the questioning of it, right? It's the awareness and then the questioning of it. So the first is to look in your physical reality and see, okay, what's going on here that's not where I, you know, want to be or where I want to be. And then look at, you know, okay, let me question and see what is it that I'm believing, thinking and believing. Because a belief is just something you think over and over and over, and then it just gets ingrained in you and it becomes part of you. So if you have, for example, if you are having a desire to start something for yourself, like even if it's a part-time business, it doesn't necessarily have to be change your whole life and start full-time, but you always wanted to have a creative expression, or there's something that you create or service or product, and you really want to do this, but you're thinking, oh, I'm not qualified to be an entrepreneur. I don't have that in, you know, in my generations. I don't see anybody that's an example. Or, oh, because I'm, you know, I hear this one a lot, because I'm shy and timid and I'm an introvert, I could never be an entrepreneur. And there's probably a ton of beliefs that are in your consciousness right now that are butting up against what it is you desire. So the first thing is to be honest with yourself of what it is you wish you could have that you don't have right now. And then look at, well, why don't you have it? And allow yourself to let the thoughts of why you don't have it come authentically without feeling like you need to judge every thought. I always like to, again, make lists of this. So over time, I can learn, oh, this is what's going on. And then when I catch these beliefs, I tend to look at the lists that I create, and I look at how do I feel in my body. So I look at each thought, and usually if it's a thought that's very common, it's a belief. And then I feel it. I feel, okay, how does that feel? And if there's some that are like, oh, all over, they light me up, right? I'll feel the fear immediately. I'll feel like, you know, just all of a sudden my neck is sore, my stomach is hurting. So I know, okay, I put a score. That's what I do. Like, I'll either highlight it or I'll put like a 10 next to it. I'm like, oh, that's a big one. We got to deal with that one. And then I go through the rest of the list. Some of them are mild. So I'm like, okay, I'll look at it later. But the ones that are like score high that I highlight, those are the ones that then again, I start to question, like, is this true? And I love to use the work of Byron Katie because it's four easy questions, which is it true? Can I be absolutely sure that it's true? How do I feel when I'm integrated into this belief? And then who would I be if I did not have this belief? So I love to use her work because it's so clean and clear. And then I question those beliefs. And it's not one time. I mean, I can only speak in my experience and my experience that I've seen with clients. Rarely do you break through magic in that doing it one time. It's the work of continuously questioning those beliefs.
And it is. It's a process. I think, you know, I had a question with one of my guests and we chatted after a show. It was probably over a year ago. And the question was kind of like, how do you get from where you are to this very high level? And he said, you don't. He goes, you get from where you are to the next step, and then the next step, and the next step. So stop focusing over there and just focus on the next step. And that was just, it was kind of enlightening, and it just made things so much easier. You do this work in steps, and it compounds, just like your money compounds. You've made a comment a couple times of being qualified to be an entrepreneur. What does it mean to be qualified to be an entrepreneur?
Yeah, you know what? I hear that with my clients all the time because I have a group coaching program that's actually for new entrepreneurs. So I hear this constantly of people saying like, you know, I really want to do this, but I wonder if am I meant to be? So qualified, am I meant to be? Can I be? And it's that question of there's so many, again, what you said with what we believe from our parents, there's so much in society of people pick up these beliefs that, oh, this is what it looks like. They'll pick whoever they've seen either on social media or on TV or somewhere, they'll pick a role model and they'll say, I'm not like that person. You know, I'm not that outgoing. I'm not this, I'm not that. So, and then they'll, this is what I hear all the time. They'll say to me all the reasons why they're doubting if they can do this. They really want it. They really desire it, but okay, I'm not this, I'm not this, I'm not this. Can I do this? So for me, I probably, if you were to look at some of the things I hear them say, I'm like, I wouldn't qualify under that list either, because I mean, I've had to break through so many of the things you're saying, because when I started 10 years ago, I would have been timid and I would have been, you know, introvert and all of those things that they come to me and they say, this is why I can't do it. So to me, I look at like, what does it take to be an entrepreneur? It takes a curiosity of, and this is just me and my list, right? It takes actually a natural curiosity to want to learn, to be a lifelong learner, because nothing in business and, you know, in being an entrepreneur is static. It's constantly changing all the time. I mean, COVID has been rocked a lot of people's businesses for sure. But even during a normal good year where not much happens, there's still going to be lots of changes in business. So wanting to, you know, be curious about learning and being okay with that, that to me is something that if you have a desire, be open to the fact that's what it's going to look like. And you're going to continuously have to do that, as well as, you know, being willing to ask for help. Because again, we have a ton of beliefs we need to break through. We have a million things we don't know that we need to go find somebody that can help us to learn how to do it. So to me, those like basic qualities of being curious, of being willing to ask for help. And if you're like really wanting to be like a conscious entrepreneur and work and grow yourself, then also I would add that to the list of wanting to do your own self-work. So let the business reflect back to you. Okay, where's the next thing I got to work on? I just hit this block in business and I realize it's not actually a business system issue. It's my stuff that I'm coming up against. So then you may be open also to work on yourself and to grow yourself personally. But to me, those are the high level things that if you're going to come up against in being an entrepreneur, not so much I would call them qualifications, but I hear it all the time of people coming to me saying, I have such a desire. I have this idea, but I don't think I can do this because of this, this, and that. Does that make sense?
It makes total sense. And you've kind of alluded to this comment constantly of being a lifelong learner. And I think this is a part where people may get a little bit stuck. And what I mean by that is, in the past, you went to college, you graduated, maybe you went back and got an advanced degree, and the world didn't change very much. And so you could kind of skate through life pretty well. But in today's world, which has gotten even hyper faster because of COVID, things are constantly changing. And even if you want to stay an employee, if you are not constantly learning and upping your game, you're going to get hammered at some point just because of the world changing so fast. And so everyone's got to essentially stay on top of their game. The ability to coast like we might have been able to do in the past is going to be much more difficult. So the question I have for you is, can anyone start a profitable business, or does it take a certain kind of person?
The way I always answer that question is, there is one thing that's non-negotiable, and that is, do you have an actual desire to do this? Where again, it's like the conditioning. Do you want to do this because someone else is telling you that this would be good for you, or that or you're hoping to get somebody's approval by starting a business, you know, hoping to prove something to the world by starting a business? So to me, the first thing that I look for is, why do you want this? Do you really want this? And if that's a yes, then we go into the things, like you said, the lifelong learner, then we go into learning mode. Okay, well, you probably don't know how to launch your idea. You probably don't even know how to explore your idea. If you're like brand new to this, there now you're going to go down a road of learning after learning after learning. So can you build a business, a profitable business, when you decide that this is truly what I want and I'm willing to learn how to do the next step and the next step? Then my answer is yes, absolutely you can. But it's not so much magic. It's one foot in front of the other. It's learning, applying, going back to drawing board sometimes, and then having to go get help again. But yes, I believe that anyone can have a profitable business if they choose to learn how to.
And that's true. I think one thing people struggle with is they come up with an idea and then they get stuck on it and they refuse to pivot. And part of business is, it's not about you. It's about, what does the customer want? And what are they willing to pay for and happy to pay for? Today's episode is sponsored by Profit Answer Man Podcast. Did you know that most small business owners hate looking at their financials? It's one reason they may struggle with business success. The Profit Answer Man Podcast helps them ensure they are profitable and can pay their employees and weather the storms we all have to face. It's built on the profit first methodology of pay yourself first. The Profit Answer Man Podcast is a must listen to for every small business owner and anyone who wants to help them survive and thrive. Check it out on your favorite listening platform. So how do you kind of figure out that mix between what you want to do and what you enjoy, but what the world is willing to pay for?
Yes, I actually have a system for that because this is very common. I get this all the time. So for me, I actually take my students through four steps, which is the first is actually I have them make a list of all of their skills, their experience, and their talents. It's just paper if you want, but I prefer Excel sheet because it's easier to work with after. And you just write down every skill you've ever had, experience you've had, talents. And I always say also go and ask, you know, people you trust, not, you know, somebody you don't trust, but somebody you trust to help build your list, because sometimes we're the worst ones at seeing our gifts and our talents. So first make a list of everything you have that you could potentially do something with, a service or a product. So that's the first thing. Then I have them actually then evaluate the market value for that. So I have them go through each one of line by line of those skills, experience, talents, and what could be the market value for that? What could you create a product with that skill? Could you create a service with that skill? And then the next piece is looking at profit potential. So if you could do something with that, there's something the market would want with that particular skill or experience, then what could be the profit potential? Actually do the numbers. Start to look at, okay, well, how many sessions, if it's a service, how many sessions would you have to do to make X amount of money? Or if it's a product, how many, you know, what would you sell your product for? What would be the projected expenses? What could, and it's projected. I get it's projected, but projected is better than no numbers. And then the last thing I have them do is also look at their lifestyle and at what's resonant with them, whether this is an idea that they can get behind enough to do it. It doesn't have to be your passion for life, because your one business you start doesn't have to be the business for the rest of your life. You got to get your feet wet somewhere. You got to start a business somewhere, and you could transition and do something else later. So it's not like a lifelong commitment to this business, but you know, check your lifestyle. Like, is this what you're trying to create also going to meet the lifestyle that you want? So I have them go through all those steps to be able to examine their ideas, to get an idea that they can align to, because you wouldn't want to start a business that you hate. That's probably not going to be very successful overall for the human being. So you want to align to it, but then will other people also align to it so that you can have profit?
You know, it's funny. Hardly anybody runs the numbers.
I know.
It just amazes me. If so much heartache would be fixed if you would just run the numbers up front to realize this isn't going to work. Like, yes, this idea doesn't cut it. Or you run the numbers and then you'll say, okay, well, I can't do it at this price point. I can do it at that price point. Then the numbers work. Then the question is how do I create value at that price point? But most people kind of ignore that. The second thing they don't do is build up a cash runway. Mm-hmm. I tell most entrepreneurs, this is a 3-year journey. Like, it's going to take time. Nothing happens overnight. So you've got to figure out, how are you going to handle the next 3 years? As long as you have the cash flow to cover your 3 years, you won't be desperate. And nobody buys from somebody who's desperate. So you've got to figure out that kind of a runway. And then on top of that, it's how much is it going to cost me to start my business? And there are ways to bootstrap businesses. And that is the smarter thing to do, is to bootstrap your business instead of spending all this money building websites and worrying about things that aren't important. And like, go get sales first. Don't worry about websites and business cards and branding. And unfortunately, I think that's what happens. A lot of people, as they're starting a business, do all the things they think they're supposed to that doesn't matter. And they waste 6 months and then they wonder why they're nowhere. It's because they haven't talked to a customer yet. they expect people to show up. And in business, more often than not, people don't just show up and say, I want to buy your product.
And they don't show up because you put up a website.
Yeah, that's correct. Nobody can find your website. There's 10 billion websites. Like, somebody has to drive them to that website. And that kind of leads to the thing, because I think this is the one thing that holds everybody back. Everyone thinks you need to be perfect before you do something. And you don't. Actually, one of my favorite people who always does things, or at least he seems like he does a lot of stuff messy, is Dan Miller, who was on a couple weeks ago. Dan just starts and he just keeps going, and then he keeps fixing things over time, and he finds people to help him, but he doesn't worry about perfection. What do you think?
I completely agree. And I think that that holds people back so much. Even they get stuck in the idea stage because they feel like the idea has to be perfect. This has to be the perfect idea. And they get very secretive about their ideas. And they're like, oh, okay, I want to run this idea by you, but can I trust you? And I love that question, because it's like, the money is not in the idea. It's in the execution of the idea. And I don't even think there's anything as such as perfect as a human being. I think by definition, if you're alive here on earth and you're a human being, you're not perfect, because you're growing and things are changing. There's somebody, you'll find somebody that will say something's wrong with you. And, you know, that's just human nature. There's always going to be other people's opinions, and you're always going to have different thoughts and beliefs going on all over, you know, in your mind and so on. But it took me a long time to not buy into the perfectionism, because coming from a corporate environment and remember, my obsession was identifying myself with being, you know, the best student and then the best employee. So I definitely had that OCD behavior of needing to be as perfect can be. And that led me, I believe that really led into that space of when I had that, you know, really intense anxiety in leaving corporate, because the pressure I had put on myself to, you know, just be perfect, rehearse everything. You know, I was in product management. So, and I had national projects that I was responsible for, and the obsession over, like, I had hundreds and hundreds of people to manage, and I literally had to manage every little detail because I was trying to be perfect. And for me, I can say in my experience, that didn't lead me to the greatest well-being. So I think that if you aim for better, so instead of wherever you have perfect, whatever you're thinking now that I got to do this, it's got to be perfect. If you just switch the word with better, better than me, than I did yesterday. So, okay, this is where I'm at today. Now I'm going to get better. One thing I see that's very common, especially with all my, you know, my students in Idea to Profit in the group coaching program, a lot of them have challenges being on camera at first. And a lot of my program, I do challenge them to be on camera in our private group. And they'll say to me, they'll be like, okay, how's this? Is this better? And within a few weeks, they're feeling better. They're feeling more comfortable. They're not looking for perfection, but they're looking and saying, oh, when I first did a video like a few weeks ago, a few months ago, okay, now I'm so much better. So it's whatever it is you're trying to do, it's just switching the word perfect with better. In my opinion, it will give you a lot more peace and well-being.
Now that I'm thinking back, when I first started the podcast and I'd have an interview, I would probably show up almost 30 minutes in advance and start making sure that everything was perfect, getting everything in order, and just having a ton of anxiety over it. Now I show up about 30 seconds before we go live. And I don't worry. Like, I've learned to let go of all of those things because I've just practiced, I guess. You get more comfortable over time. And little by little, you get there. But you have to show up and take the first step.
For sure. And it is. It is a progress, right? It's like, you're going to get there. You're always going to get better if you keep doing something. Keep learning, keep doing, you're going to get better.
So what are some important things that people need to keep in mind as they switch from a job to a business? Because it's got different mindsets, different behaviors, and different way of doing things.
Yes. And I can tell you from my experience and having coached a lot of clients through those transitions, to me, there's a few things that I see work every time. And number one is the structure piece. Because if you're coming from a job, you have structure around you. So I always like to compare, like, having a job is kind of like swimming in a swimming pool. It's like, you know, you've got, you know, a space to swim in, and you've got walls to keep you in. As long as you can swim, you're safe, you're good. And all of a sudden you're swimming in the ocean. there's really nothing to keep you in. If you swim too far and you get yourself in trouble, oh, you got to figure it out. You got to now, okay, what am I going to do? How am I going to, you know, take care of myself? So business is very much, there's beautiful that you have freedom. That's what we all want when we start business. But then you also have to be responsible for the structure that you're going to create for yourself. So that's one of the number one things I always work on with clients, is making sure that they are taking some of the structure that even worked for them in a job, that they had maybe other people they were, you know, like they were keeping them accountable there in that structure that they created for themselves. And that could be making sure that you have, you know, reminders that are going to tell you what to do, when to do it, that you actually keep appointments in your calendar, even if you feel like, well, this is just an appointment for me to, you know, do something. It's schedule it in, schedule your time, and make sure that you are doing some form of planning as well. Because usually sometimes in corporate, people told you, okay, this is our vision, this is what your role is going to be, this is what you're going to do, but you're going to wear a lot of hats as a business owner. So having a format of doing planning, which a lot of creative entrepreneurs, it's like they're allergic to the word plan, but having some sort of plan that you can structure yourself inside of your business, because yes, you get to be your own boss, but you know what? Guess what? You have to be your own boss, right? The other thing that goes with that, very much aligns with that as well, is the self-accountability. And this may be different than what you hear other people say, but I'm a big believer when you become a business owner, entrepreneur, whatever you identify with, that you do want to cultivate self-accountability. Yes, sometimes you can recognize it's not a strong suit for you, so you can get an accountability buddy, or that's why people get coaches a lot of time, is because they know they need the accountability. But with my clients, I always teach them how to be self-accountable rather than take on their accountability role. Because if you're going to be in business for the long run, learning self-accountability is like a survival skill in this world. So that's something that, rather than, you know, take that on and always, you know, be that crutch for them, I always teach them what it looks like to be accountable to yourself, which that actually is a lot of personal development too. It's a lot of learning your value, of finding your worth, believing that your well-being is worth it, you're worth it. And doing some of that work also helps people to come back to a place of self-accountability. And the third thing I'll just say when it comes to transitioning is also the redefining your relationship with failure. Because again, just my experience in corporate world, there's a little bit more mercy there of like, you know, or at least we don't put so much pressure on, okay, well, if that went wrong, somebody else will come and help me. There's a team, like we can all kind of figure it out. And then there's so much pressure when you're on your own that you're like, okay, I can't fail. Or everybody that I worked with say, oh, I told you so, told you shouldn't have left this job, or you shouldn't start a business. You're accountable. You feel like, oh my God, what was my family going to say? And then there's a financial worry. So there's so much pressure not to fail, where you're in an environment where there's going to be failures, sometimes micro failures, sometimes smaller, bigger failures. But it's that redefining the relationship, because part of business ownership over time is learning from failures. Some of my greatest learnings have come from things that did not work out. And all of a sudden I was like, oh, I understand myself so much better. And I understand my audience so much better, and how to market and how to grow my business. So redefining that relationship, I think that with self-accountability and creating structure, those are kind of, to me, like the bones of putting together a new business owner.
And it takes time and work, and little by little, you will get there. As yes. long as you keep showing up. And it's funny because, as you know, as I'm building my business, I keep getting surprised at the increase in opportunity of what's out there, and seeing more possibility to. And when I say that, what I mean is work less, make more. And so it's not like I'm going more. It's learning to work less, but still make more. And I think that that's always a good balance, because this is a lifestyle business for me. I don't want it to take over my life, because that would just not be fun. One of the biggest struggles I had, and I see this struggle a lot with people, is there's a lot of people who go, I want to start a business, but they don't have an idea. They don't even know what they want to do. What do you do at that point?
Yeah, that's a great question. And again, I go back to what I said about desire. So somebody comes to me, which I do, like, often have strategy calls with people that are like, I really want to do this, but I'm so stuck. I can't even think of anything. I can't think of an idea. So again, I ask them the fundamental question of like, do you desire this? Why do you desire this? And we can do a little bit of digging just to see if there's an alignment there and why they want to be in business. And then the next thing is, okay, well, an idea, creativity is something that I know a lot of people will say, no, you either are creative, you either have ideas or you don't. That has not been my experience. I've worked with a lot of people that either have a whole bunch of ideas and it's really no idea because they can't make sense of any of them, or they just have a desire and they don't really specifically know what to do. I actually take them through the same process that I mentioned earlier of having them list out all their skills, their experience, and their talents, having them do market value and profit potential and lifetime assessment. I actually take them through that same system. And the only thing I do that's a fifth step there, if somebody has like had no idea and is very stuck, is actually do a little bit of brainstorm work with them with an actual, it's a little bit of meditation hypnosis as well that frees up creativity. Because when I dig into when they truly want to have a desire and I can feel it, energetically feel that they're aligned to it and they say they have been blocked from ideas. Every single time I've dug down with people, it's because they've actually blocked their creativity because their left brain is on and engaged and they think they have to create an idea mechanically with their left brain, where it doesn't happen that way. Ideas come in from creative and from right brain. So doing some work of allowing them to kind of shut off the left a little bit, bring the right online and then bring them together online. And I give them a lot of freedom to brainstorm for a while. Then they start to get a bunch of ideas. And then I take them through my four-step process, and then they come up at the end, they can see viable ideas. I usually have them rate their top 10, and then we go to top 3. And then once they get the one, then we take it through the explore phase. And they don't even have to commit to that idea yet if they haven't gone through the explore phase first.
It's looking at a ton of different opportunities. It's not just one idea. It's exploring it, testing it, seeing, and then going out. And that makes a lot of sense. I think too often people don't take the time to really deep dive into what they want to do before they run off and do it. And I know you've been talking about mindset and beliefs. And it's funny because when I joined my one group that was full of business owners, I was shocked to see, like, I expected them to know everything. And these are guys who are running big businesses. And the reality was they didn't. There was a lot of struggles. There was a lot of things they didn't understand. There was a lot of imperfection. And I noticed that. And part of what was cool about the group was vulnerability, right? Because you come here and you have to tell the truth of, this is what I'm struggling with. This is what I want to do. Do I see it correctly? And what am I missing? And doing all of that. And that was really kind of eye-opening to me, was how imperfect they were, I guess. What has been your experience with vulnerability and entrepreneurs?
Anyone that knows me knows my common phrase that I use all the time, which is vulnerability has the greatest ROI always, 100% of the time. Because this is how I look at vulnerability. It's really being able to tell your truth in a time where it's, you feel you have a ton of judgment over your truth. It's inconvenient. And you already believe that, or you're scared that, oh, what's going to happen now if I'm going to share this? And there's so much mind chatter. But if you can break through that and you can actually speak your truth, whether it's one-on-one with someone that you have to, you know, confront or speak to them, or it's in a group, like when you're in, I love masterminds too for that reason, of being able to say in front of a whole of other people that, okay, I feel this way and I really need help. But in order for me to get help, I actually have to tell you everything that's going on for me so you guys can understand and be able to help me. And in my experience, personally, every time I've been vulnerable, I have gained so much. And then if I look back even in 10 years in business and I look at, okay, something that I did like 10 years ago to be vulnerable. And then that led to learning this, that led to learning that, to this, to that. So I can attribute even my progress and where I'm at to vulnerabilities that I chose to be vulnerable 10 years ago. So to me, it's like there's such a huge return on choosing to be vulnerable. And yes, I acknowledge that it takes a lot of courage. And sometimes you don't actually have the courage. Sometimes it's like, I like to say there's like a courage bank and you can go look in your courage bank and you're like, oh, I don't have enough to cover this. Like, I don't have enough courage in the bank. And you got to take out a loan. You got to take out a courage loan and trust that it's going to come back to you. And it will. You'll be able to put so much courage back in that bank once you show up and you're vulnerable. And I, you know, in the spirit of vulnerability, I'll give you an example because sometimes people are like, what does that really mean? So for me, this is a way of life. Like, I choose to be vulnerable all the time because I know the return. So just a couple of weeks ago, I was talking to someone that I actually was interviewing for my group. I have Entrepreneur Spotlight, which I interview different entrepreneurs. And this woman is like, she impressed me so much. She was doing all these amazing things. And a lot of things that she was creating in her business is dreams I've had. I was like, oh, I wish somebody could do this or that. And I was so in love with the conversation, but another part of me felt unworthy. Like, oh my God, I can't believe that she gave me her time. I'm taking up too much of her time. And then we finished the conversation. I sat in my office and I was like, okay, I can sweep this under the rug that I just totally felt unworthy to talk to her, or I can be vulnerable and tell her that. So I did immediately got on my email and sent her a note and said everything. I said, listen, we just had this great conversation. I really admire you. I think you're doing amazing work. I'm so excited to interview you. And when I was talking to you, I really hit my unworthiness and I felt like I was wasting your time. And I just said everything. And she emailed me back saying, oh my God, thank you for being honest. I felt the same about you. And it's like, and we brought us together so much more. And I mean, I think she's somebody I'm going to definitely keep in touch with in my life, such a beautiful soul. But for me, it was that moment of, I got off the call with her. And I thought, if I don't admit this, I'm going to hold on to this shame. And you know what happens when you hold on to shame? Like, there's no way you can match well-being. You can't be at your best and well in great health and mental, emotional, physical, if you're hanging on to little shames. So for me, I know sometimes it feels obsessive because I'm like, if it comes to my mind, I need to correct it. I'm like, no, I need to get on the phone with that person, or I need to do something to correct something that I'm going to hold on to as a little shame. Does that make sense?
It makes total sense. And it's funny because we constantly put everyone else on pedestals.
Yes.
And the reality is they're not on a pedestal. We're all on our own pedestal, and you need to stop. Everybody puts on their pants, right? One leg at a time, the same way. We're all just people. But that's a script, and learning to let go of that script is difficult. And I think it's true, because the wealthiest people have a problem is they struggle because they don't know if you're there for them or for their money. Mm-hmm. Right. Same thing. Like, I know good looking women have the same issue. It's like, are you here because of my looks or because you want to know me as a person? And also because of that, people don't approach those people because they don't feel worthy. And yet these people are you know, looking for those types of connections. So it's funny how that all kind of comes together.
Yes, very true.
We always like to give the listeners an action step, something they can do this week to move forward. Is there something that you recommend? What can people do this week to take a step forward in life?
I am going to recommend what's present for me this week. And this is what I have my students doing as well. And one thing that I've learned over the years of, you know, accepting my unique gift is reading energy and reading what's present. And what I feel very strongly that I've been going through and I've had multiple clients going through is questioning value and worth. So one action that I actually have all my students doing this week is allow yourself to let all of the statements that you have running through your mind about your own value and worthiness come to awareness. So you have to ask for permission, because if we're, you know, there's a ton of stuff going on all the time and like that we have gathered in our, you know, be it ourselves or in our mind, memories, everything, but we have to call those out and we have to say, I now allow and I give permission to know what my truth is around value and around my worthiness. And I always like to add to anything to do with money, because money and value are so, so attached that it's going to come through anyway. So give it permission too. And then spend a week just making a list of this. Now I say specifically a list rather than start to work on each one, because as soon as you kind of deep dive into one, you kind of lose the list and you lose the full inventory of it. So just spend a week, whether you're going to use, you know, your phone to make notes or you're a pen and paper person. I love to write my journals, pen and paper, whatever works for you. Just give yourself, you know, like a 7-day window where you're like, okay, I am allowing and I'm going to be vulnerable and I'm going to accept to hear what is really truly in my belief system and in my mind around my own value, what I bring to the world and my worthiness and anything connected to money values. And then just anytime, like you could be eating dinner and having a conversation, not even be thinking about it. And all of a sudden it pops in, put it on your list. Just keep putting it on your list. At the end of the week, then dedicate some time I like to say good hour that you can sit with it and then go through them and see like what comes out stronger for you. So when you look at the list, it could be a short list or a long list. Everybody's different. Again, don't look for perfect. There is no perfect, like it has to be this or that. Just look at the list that you've gathered and go through each one and feel them through your body. Feel them. Which ones are like, oh gosh, yes. Like I said earlier, I do this all the time for different things. If they feel like a 10, highlight them or put a 10 next to it. And those would be the ones that you want to take some more time in question. And if you look up Byron Katie's work, she's got a ton of work, you know, for free. You can find the question, like the questions I mentioned, just if you Google that, it's very easy to find. And, or if you have a different method of questioning it, but go through and then question those statements that are coming through for you and see if you can start to separate yourself from those beliefs that are not helping you or working for you. And in that questioning, I always find that there's a separation from it. At least they're not inside of you running the show. You're starting to see them in and around you. So you're more aware of them. So their energy to take you over is less and less every time you question it. But that's the action I would say is first start with a 7-day inventory. Okay, what is true about me, value, worth, and money? Does that make sense?
It makes total sense. And I think it's a good thing for people to do, especially these times. I know a lot of my clients, because of COVID, they've actually had to do much more inventory of themselves and what's going on. It's forced them to say, okay, I actually have to do something. I know I should have done something all these years, but now I'm kind of pushed to the brink. And so take the time and do the inventory. It's time to learn the secrets of life. What's your secret to living an abundant life?
Constantly questioning the thoughts that are in the way of living an abundant life.
Right? Getting rid of the roadblocks, the yes. things that are preventing you from living the life of your dreams. And
yes.
Excellent advice. What did you learn later in life that you wish you would have learned sooner?
That it's okay to be me. The being different is my greatest asset.
And we're all different. We are all unique human beings. And you've got to use, I mean, that's what creates the most opportunity is uniqueness. Although we're not taught that. We're taught the opposite. We're taught to fit in. If everyone is the same and everything's plain vanilla, then you're no better than somebody else. It's when you're unique that that tremendous value comes out.
Yes.
If you were to give an 18-year-old one specific piece of wisdom, what would it be?
Have fun. Because you know what? We've become a society in general of taking everything so seriously. And I mean, we can look at mental health and the challenge it is across the world. And yeah, you want to be responsible and, you know, do things that are good for your well-being in life. But have fun. I don't know where in Europe, this is not as true. Like people still have more joy for life. But I find in North America, in large part, we've come to this to be the society that's so bogged down by, okay, you're 18, you've got to figure out what you want to do and then go to university and do it and then figure out your life. Like, let's just enjoy joy. Let's have a little bit of fun with everything else we're doing with life. That is what I wish somebody would have explained and said to me when I was 18.
And that is important. Enjoy the journey, because that is where life happens, on the way. And if you're not enjoying it, you've got a major problem there.
Yes.
You mentioned before we started recording, you have a special offer for our listeners. Can you share that and where to find you?
Yeah, I'd love to offer your listeners a complimentary strategy session with me. If you are desiring to be an entrepreneur and that's top of mind for you, or you have a business you want to grow, and you can book that session at strategywithsandra.com. And together we can explore your profit potential and look at whether, you know, you can be in the idea stage, you can be in the desire stage, or you can have launched your business and be in the growth stage. And you want to figure out, you know, what is unique about you? How can you reach your full true potential and get the profit? Because in business, if you're not getting the profits you want, and if you're not hitting the profit lines, then sometimes you have an expensive hobby. So we want to make sure we can fix that. So yeah, for sure, strategywithsandra.com, and I would love to help you.
And I will put that in the show notes to make it easy for people. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Rocky. This was a really great time, and I had a lot of fun, which is my goal these days.
As is mine. Have you figured out what you want from life yet? Not easy sometimes. Have you changed your thoughts around the possibility of doing your own thing? For some people, it's a retirement lifestyle business. For some, it's a side hustle. And for others, this might just be your dream. Some people prefer to be entrepreneurial at work, and you can use this to help the company you work for increase their sales. It's all about changing our mindsets and consistently and constantly growing. Sandra has a great program to help you do this, and I will put a link to her program in the show notes. It's a 4-month program focused on business and personal development, and she includes weekly calls to support you. It's about half business and half personal development. This week's action step was to do a 7-day inventory of yourself. Question, what do you think you'll find? Many times we're surprised by the reality of what we want and what we actually end up doing. We've got to make sure those are in alignment. Next week, I have Dr. Salyer back to help us deal with the emotions of surviving in our current times. He's got some great information to share. Hey, if you enjoyed this episode, would you do me a favor? Would you share it with a few others? I'd appreciate that. Thanks for listening. Have an abundant week.